And thank you everyone for attending. Welcome to the last lecture. This tradition has been a staple in everyone's senior year. And this year it's our turn as the class of 2021. It's a little different from last lectures, but with great effort, you know, great student voting participation and great attendance from everyone here, it has been made possible. Today I would like to welcome a professor who has impacted the lives of so many students. No matter what major, his classes make an impression like no other. He has been described as welcoming, fun, engaging, and most importantly, impactful and understanding. So please help me welcome Professor Ibrahim Abe Abu Sharif to the floor to deliver the last lecture to the class of 2021.
All right, thank you. Let me walk to the floor. Thank you. I appreciate it. First of all, I'm honored that you all, the seniors, asked me to give this lecture, and I bid you all a very good evening, and thank you for coming. It's a bit late, I know that, and I was just telling the folks beforehand that I'm probably one of two people in the whole building, and so it is my incentive to go through this as soon as possible because I'm starting to hear noises, so I really need to finishing this thing up before something weird happens. Anyhow, thank you for your introduction, Hamed. It's generous and gracious of you. And for me, I try to aspire to be that person you just described. So thank you very much. And congratulations to our seniors. This is a big milestone for you. You're going to hear this a lot. And it's a big accomplishment. And I'm very glad to have had many of you in my classes. I regret not having all of you in my classes. I wish I did. But I know for a fact that my students, the students in my classes and my colleagues' classes, I'm sure they all agree, you have enriched the classes, you have added material value to our discussions with your intelligence, your insight, and most of all, your candor. You didn't hold back. And that's kind of the environment that anyone who teaches would like to have in our classrooms. So this past year has been extraordinary. I have to say this, I know you've heard this every day probably for last year. I can't skip over it because I know for a fact that this has been a trial for all of us and it's impacted all of us, but there is no equivalence here. You, our students, you've had to shoulder much heavier load than anybody else when it comes to the pandemic and its disruption of something as fundamental as how you learn. This is hardly a minor thing. So I'm very grateful for your engagement, your commitment to the classes and during this difficulty. And I hope you see past the cliche. And so let me get on to the lecture. There's an informal tradition in last lecturing, and that is we're all compelled to say something, how this is an unusual lecture. It's a difficult lecture to give. I've given many lectures before. They weren't all gems. I know my students will agree with that, but it deals with the materials and objectives of the class. But for last lecture, my main concern is in the enterprise of giving counsel, I'm afraid it's going to drift into preaching land. And I really hope that doesn't happen. I hope you don't, that's not the way you receive it. Anyhow, thank you very much. And, you know, I wish I had something witty to say. I Googled something witty to say, and it didn't work out. And I tried a couple of them on my wife, and I learned something that the word totally unfunny is one word. And I didn't know that before that. So I'm dropping all the pretenses of all that. And so let me get directly to what I want to say, my main message. And so we human beings, we have this penchant, this inclination and desire. Whenever we get close to the end of something, we go back to the beginning. We think about the beginning. We have this complex relationship with time, with past, even the whole notion of pastness. And so what I want to start is from a early class that the journalism students have taken. And there's a lesson in this for all our students. I'm sure you'll understand why I'm bringing this up as in due course. But in our Journalism 201 course, it's a boot camp course that I've taught for many years with Professor Mary, I'm very grateful to say. We hold a mock press conference. And it's based on a mock crime that we completely make up. And for the last couple of years, it's been about an unidentified man. He robs the Burger King store, which very oddly is at the Burger King roundabout. And he breaks in he hits a woman over the head with an iron bar. You know, we don't hold back. It was an iron ball. It wasn't a, you know, bar. It wasn't a baseball bat. And he runs off with 5,000 Qatari riyals. So it's something like this probably doesn't happen in Doha very often, but each one of us then plays a role. Professor Mary plays the daughter of the victim. In the last couple of years, we had Professor Hairo, who's a spokesman for Hamid Hospital. And the last time he did it, he started with speaking Spanish at a mile a minute. And it was precious to see our students' faces, to see how they received that information. But then he got back into character and did a brilliant job. As for me, the last couple of years, I've been landing the same role, and that's the Doha police chief, whose last name is Alibi of all things. And you know, we in the journalism department, we are factories of irony and metaphor, so I wouldn't be surprised that that's why I have the name. We have fun with this press conference, but there are two serious purposes behind them. One is explicit and one is implicit. Number one, we're asking our students to get out of their comfort zone and to ask questions. This question bit, it's really the start of every kind of inquiry, big or small, profane or sacred. We begin with a question. And our research begins with what they call research questions. They're problems to solve, and they're best pursued when we frame these problems as questions. And also we try to press upon the students that asking questions is really the most important device, the most important technology any storyteller will have, because it is the articulation of curiosity, and curiosity is really at the core of our humanity. So the implicit part is that after this mock press conference, after it's concluded and the students have to write a story on a tight deadline, there's no mock anything after that. It's real life reporting. You have to pursue stories for the rest of your storytelling career at NUQ. And you often in my classes, they get to choose their own stories and their sources. So it's really a kind of a test for them. And so after that, really no more mocking. It's sort of a transition period between the laboratory journalism and really the real life journalism. Okay, why am I bringing this up? There's something about the arrangement of undergraduate education, and I want to be very open with you. There's something about that's a little bit staged. And I'm not saying it's unreal, but it's an arrangement that really doesn't exist anywhere except during your undergraduate education and your undergraduate years. You know, the knowledge you've gained is real. The storytelling skills that you have honed, they're real. Your exposure to the world of knowledge production is real. Your discussions about global discourses, some of them very uncomfortable, about racism, identity points, freedom of speech, violence, all of this is real and preparatory, and they will be your companions after you graduate. I'm really certain of this. But college life as an organizing principle, the way you sense your day and sense your time, your obligations, is really unlike what you're going to face once you graduate. And I know some of you may have some things set up, some of you may not. Don't worry, don't panic. I can tell you my story, and it is daunting. I think everybody who's ever graduated from college, your undergraduate years, we are faced with this sort of new way of being that's unlike what we had experienced before. I remember mine very well, not because my memory is special, because I think to an important extent, I'm still not over it. It is something to consider and think about. So now there's this thing called the transition. You are in a period of transition. You're going to go to the next thing. The next thing is going to be that new organizing principle, the new thing that you are going to devote yourself to. There's no doubt about it. It's going to be somewhat different, but it will be the next thing, the next organizing principle that you will have to work with. But before you get pulled in, before you get pulled into this next thing, I want to just say that transitions are not waiting rooms where you do nothing. They're actually important moments, very important moments and opportunities for you to consider some things before you get pulled in, before you get pulled into the next hovering clouds of culture and whatever it may be. And so I want to then talk about them. I don't have a clickbait, I have five recommendations or things like that. And you won't believe the fifth one. I'm not going to do any of that, but I want you to consider the following. And they pivot on two things that are closely related. It's about disagreeing and confronting. I'm suggesting that you prepare yourself to disagree, and I'm suggesting that you prepare yourself to confront. If we just consider right now, and I think we all are aware of this, that the status of truth today, the status of truth is really under aggressive attack. Fake news, post-truth realities, these are interesting phrases, but they're also serious diagnoses of our realities today. It's amazing what people are willing to believe, no matter how implausible they are, no matter how impossible they are, but the narrative streams are out there and they keep on moving to the point where repetition seems to be the only proof of something's rectitude, the only proof of something being truthful. And so in this time, you all have had some very significant experiences learning storytelling. I just want to mention that nothing happens in the real world before the narrative. The narrative always is, it's the soil in which real world things happen. And so please use the skills, and I'm going to talk to you about that a little bit later on. Consider that you will have opportunities to confront really toxic narratives out there, and narratives can only be confronted with other narratives. This is my suggestion. And let me then bring up sister relationship or brother relationship, and that is disagreement. And I'm asking you to disagree. And so, you guys hear that, or is that me? All right. Well, disagreement, if we're human, we disagree. There's no doubt about it. And so you never give up your agency to agree to everything. And so it's a very important aspect of our human lives. In fact, I'm asking you to disagree even from your soon-to-be former professors, and to avoid falling into a single outlook where there are new issues, the new bandwagon to jump into, the new thing to believe, because we're kind of afraid of not being woke, or not being a part of our liberal chops, or whatever it may be, but really interrogate what new comes down the pipe. As I mentioned, there's nothing that happens in the real world without it being preceded by the narrative, the word. There's not a single policy that's made, an act of racism that's conducted, no insult, no slurs are hurled, unless they are preceded by some narrative that convinces people to otherize other people, to diminish their humanity. And as we know, I don't have to tell you, you know, what the situation is, but I think that narratives should be confronted with oppositional discourses or counter narratives. And I have seen your storytelling. I have seen your documentaries. I have seen the fantastic work that you have done. And so I'm suggesting that when you have an opportunity to learn, to really take on narratives, confront narratives, I'm suggesting that you just think about it. Think about doing that, because those opportunities will come. I'm not saying quit your job. I'm not saying quit. Don't be activist. Not at all. I really wish you great material success. I wish you the best of jobs, and I'm not kidding about that. I honestly wish and pray that for you. But let's just consider what we've been doing the last 4 years, what you have been doing. You've been studying very powerful skills in the art of media production and conveyance. And you have learned it from programs that have a really good history of teaching them. And you have learned from scholars in the fields of social sciences and humanity. And you have been grounded in knowledge of the region. And you have done all of this in a region of the world that seems to be at the epicenter of media attention. And I don't think this is going to change. And it's sort of like the, I wouldn't call it, and also let me just get to that, is that you have learned with the most diverse student body that I've ever come across. I've never seen a student body like this before. It's extraordinary, and it's informing, and it really just helps the overall progress. But you know, this is not a perfect storm at all. It's actually the perfect situation for you all to be part of the solution, which I hope you want to do. NUQ is not a rescue mission. You never needed to be rescued. You never needed to be saved, not saved from yourselves. All you needed was an education, which makes us all peers. Every one of your professors who stood before you in class, speaking and teaching and giving examples, we all sat where you used to sit. And so ask for rescuing. I'm suggesting that really the ones who are in position of rescuing are you, that we are in a time right now in which we sort of need a new narrative stream, a new way of confronting, I think, what I continue to talk about as toxic narratives. We've seen this before. It's a noble enterprise and we all need it. So during this transition period, I want to end with a couple things that I hope you would consider to prepare yourself and really to think about the next steps. And that is for you to get to know your inner sanctum, get to know yourself. Consider tuning out a bit. I mean, I've done this before in my life where I really sort of fasted completely from certain media streams because I wanted to get back into it at my own in my own terms. So the inner sanctum, sometimes it's your scruples, it's what you believe in, it's your assumptions, it's your premises, it's where these important aspects of your side, where they reside. And this is where actually you have more agency than anything else in the external world. So let me ask you to do a couple of things. Number one is that is to be charitable. Please be charitable with your time, whatever resources you can give, whatever talent that you have, please put it at the service of others, especially the underprivileged and the challenged. And also I would recommend that when you do that, don't tell anybody about it. Don't take pictures of it and post it on Twitter or whatever it may be, because this thing that we call sincerity, it is a real deal. It informs everything you do. It makes everything bittersweet and makes everything ineffective effective. And so I just really think that if you consider being charitable with your time, whether it's working at a shelter for animals or helping underprivileged kids learn or something like this, this is the good fight. This really is a good fight. I don't think there's a better fight than this. So my hope and my prayers for you is I really wish success for you. And I hope that when you get settled and the new thing comes to you, I hope you progress. I hope you take over. You know, I hope that you just, not through a coup, of course, but through your talent and whatever graduate school you go to, I hope you excel and you become the top of your class. And there's no necessary conflict between material success and personal issues of the inner sanctum. So if you need any help from us, the staff, faculty, and UQ, we're all there to help you in the future. I get emails from students I've taught 10 years ago, and I never tire from this. We never tire from being there for you. And again, I'm asking for all of you to, first of all, to consider your next steps and consider conditioning the things that you need to do before you're consumed with another thing. And we all are, we all get in these things. So I wish you great success. And I know it's late and I promised Indy and Hamid that I'm gonna be brief with this. So just to summarize, folks, please consider when you get the time to confront bad narratives. I think this is where you come in. I've seen your documentaries, I've seen them. And they're extraordinary. And I've seen the stories you've written for me in my classes. And I've seen that your papers that you're in, like in my media religion class. I mean, top-notch thinking, top-notch courage. You are courageous. And you have the experience that other people don't have. And then you can tell the stories that nobody else is capable of telling. So this is my suggestion. This is my quick message. And so this is where I'm going to leave. I wish you all the best. I pray for your success. And I mean that with not as a preacher, but really as a person who really admires you. I really admire you a lot. I'm really impressed by your successes. And you have enriched my life. There's no doubt about it. And that's my story. And I'm sticking to it. All right. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Abe. And thank you for everything that you've done for the seniors and honestly, our entire Wildcat community, whether it's us or whoever is coming in, pretty sure they will be impacted by you. So since we have some time on our hands, I thought of opening up the floor if any of our seniors would like to share anything or if anyone has a fun memory with Professor Abe or any fun memory that they'd like to share. I think that would be really